Our today's topic is preparation of cocoons for marketing. Content of this topic is desirable physical features of cocoon, undesirable cocoons, transport of cocoons, cocoon markets. Introduction. Cocoons are to be sorted, graded, and quickly sold in the market to avoid the possibility of emergence of adult moth. Because if we are late in selling the cocoons, then the pupa will metamorphose into adult and it will pierce the cocoon and come out, which is not good because such cocoons are useless. Cocoons which are defective and of poor quality should be removed, as price of the lot is fixed based on the random sampling. So whatever lot is taken to the market, from that any small amount is taken out as sample, so the whole lot should be of good quality. Milky and flimsy cocoons should be removed because these cocoons exude fluid and it stains and spoils the neighboring good cocoons. Following are the desirable physical features of the cocoon. The farmer has to check all the cocoons have these physical features. First is color. Color is race dependent. For example, if we take Bombyx mori, you will find different types of cocoons, white, grayish white, silver white, yellow, golden yellow. But white cocoons are preferred because the silk that you get is white in color and that can be blended. You can make it into different colored silk. Shape, different shapes cocoons are there. This is again a racial feature. Depending upon the race of the variety, different cocoons are found. It can be spherical, it can be constricted, it can be fusiform, oval or elliptical. Usually oval or spherical cocoons are preferred because it is easy to reel them. Next character is size. Large and uniform sized cocoons are preferred because large cocoons are easy to reel. This is a race dependent character, but feeding and rearing method also have some effect on size. If feeding and rearing is not done properly, then the larvae are not of equal size and you get unequals and you get small cocoons. Compactness of cocoon shell. Cocoon should be firm and a little resilient. That means when you press the cocoon slightly between your fingers and leave it, it has to come back to its original shape. So that is called as resilient. Compactness of cocoon shell again is a racial character, but it is influenced by rearing method. So proper rearing method, if followed, you get good cocoons. Cocoon weight. Heavy cocoons fetch more price because more weight means more silk. Weight of cocoon decreases with increase in time. So when you harvest the cocoon, the weight is more, and over a period of time its weight goes on decreasing. Therefore it is advised you should sell the cocoon as soon as it is harvested. Hybrid race cocoons are heavier than pure race varieties. Male cocoons are lighter than female cocoons. In this diagrammatic representation, you can see female cocoons, newly harvested cocoon, hybrid cocoons are having more weight. Male cocoons and those cocoons which are harvested and time has lapsed, then pure race cocoons, they have less weight. Shell weight. Silk is obtained from the shell. Therefore, shell weight is very important. It is more important than cocoon weight. Multivoltine hybrid varieties have shell weight around 0.15 to 0.25 grams, whereas bivoltine hybrids have 0.30 to 0.50 grams. More shell weight means more silk. Unbreakable length of the filament. Average length of silk filament obtained from a single cocoon without breaking is called as unbreakable length of the filament. This has to be more. Thickness of silk filament. The unit for measuring the thickness of silk filament is denier. Denier is weight of 9000 meter length of silk expressed in grams. Usually superior cocoons have smaller denier. So if you see a silk filament which is very thin, it is 900 meters long, its denier size will be less. And if it is thick, then its denier size will be more. So small denier size is preferred because it can be easily blended with other fabrics such as cotton, polyester, and made into fabrics. Filament length. The length of the silk thread obtained when reeled from a single cocoon using epruvate is the filament length of that cocoon. So epruvate is a single cocoon reeling machine. So from the whole lot, a single cocoon is taken and its filament length is taken, and that is said to be the filament length of the whole lot of cocoon that you are having. Multivoltine Indian varieties have 330 to 400 meters length of filament. Multivoltine Indian hybrid varieties have 400 to 650 meters. Multivoltine Indian crossbreeds have 800 to 1200 meters. And bivoltine cocoon varieties have very good length, 1000 to 1600 meters. Floss percentage. Unreelable mass of loose silk covering the cocoon shell is the floss percentage. Multivoltine species have more floss than bivoltine. Rendita. The number of kg of cocoon required to get 1 kg reeled silk is known as rendita. So multivoltine species have more rendita. That means the number of cocoons required to produce 1 kg silk is more. That means the silk that you are getting from the cocoon is less. That is why you need more cocoons, right? And in case of bivoltine, the rendita is less. So less number of cocoons are required to get 1 kg reeled silk. Okay, that means bivoltines have more silk in the cocoons. Reliability. The ease with which cocoon filament can be unwound is called as reliability. It represents the percentage ratio of unbroken filament to the whole filament length. Bivoltines have better reliability as compared to multivoltines. That is why on multi-end reeling machines, usually bivoltines are used. Multivoltines, especially Indian multivoltines, cannot be reeled on multi-end machines. Usually, charkha or cottage basin reeling is done. Sorting of undesirable cocoons. So, the farmer, before taking his cocoons to market for selling, has to remove all the defective cocoons. Because if defective cocoons come in the sampling, then the whole lot will be considered defective and price that he will be getting will be less. So what sort of cocoons he has to remove from the lot? Cocoon defects resulting from mistake in rearing and mounting methods. So here you can have double cocoons. When there is overcrowding on the Chandrika or any other mountage of the mature worms, then they make cocoons very near to each other and both the cocoons stick to each other. So this is called as double cocoons. So such cocoons are not reliable, so they fetch less price. Immature cocoons. Unripe worms, when mounted, spin small cocoon. Because at the end of their life, the larvae did not get food, and small larvae spin small cocoons. Premature cocoon. Harvesting of cocoon before the larvae transforms into pupa. So inside the cocoon, the larvae is not fully transformed into pupa, and such cocoons will cause problem. Unequal cocoons. Insufficient feed leads to different sized worms, and they produce different sized cocoons. Malformed cocoons. Abnormal shaped cocoon having uneven texture or not suitable for mechanical reeling. This usually happens because of improper rearing methods, such as crowding on the mount edge, fluctuation in temperature and humidity during spinning, disturbance of the worms during spinning. All these result in malformed cocoons. Black stained or inside soiled cocoon. Sometimes the pupa dies inside. This may be due to disease condition. So if the larva is having any disease, fungal disease or bacterial disease, and if it spins a cocoon, then it dies inside the cocoon. And such dead pupa ooze fluid, because of which the cocoon gets soiled, and adjoining to it, other good cocoons will also get soiled. So such black stained or soiled cocoons have to be removed immediately. Mute cocoons. Dead pupa stick to the shell from within, because usually a good cocoon, when you take it between your finger and move it, you can hear the sound of the pupa. But when you cannot hear the sound of the pupa, if it is a mute cocoon, that means the pupa inside is dead and is sticking to the shell from within. So such cocoons have to be removed. Rusts outside or soiled cocoons. This might be due to the excreta of other worms. Calcified cocoons. This happens when, because of fungal infection, the pupa inside is infected and it is mummified. So for example, we have calcino. In that case, it happens. Loose knot. Fragile or thin-shelled cocoon. Here the cocoons have very loose knots on them, and the shell is also very fragile. So it's not possible to reel such cocoons. So these cocoons have to be removed. Double-layered cocoons. Cocoons with 2 to 3 layers of shell due to drastic environmental changes during spinning. So such cocoons from outside, you cannot tell it is a double-layered cocoon. The only thing is that it appears slightly larger than the rest of the cocoon. So that is double layered cocoon. So such cocoons also has to be removed. Defects due to parasitic infestation. So if there is parasitic infestation of oozy fly or dermastid beetle, then perforated cocoons are there. So such perforated cocoons have to be removed. Defect due to moth emergence. So if you are harvesting your cocoon late, then the adult moth will emerge out, and such pierced cocoon, because of the emergence of the adult moth, do not fetch any price. They have to be removed from the lot. Transport of cocoons. After removing the defective cocoons and retaining those cocoons which have desirable parameters, they are taken to the market. Cocoons harvested are to be transported to the centralized market quickly. The Central Silk Board has recognized some centers from every state as its centralized markets. So all the adjoining farmers take their cocoons there for selling. Avoid transportation in heap or closed bag, because it causes perspiration of the cocoon. And because of this, what happens is the sericin layer of the cocoon is affected, and it causes problem in reeling. Transportation should be fast, and it should be in perforated containers to avoid perspiration. Avoid sudden jerks during transportation because sudden jerks will kill the pupa. Sudden changes in temperature, environmental condition will also kill the pupa, which is not good because if the pupa dies inside the cocoon, then such cocoons are rejected. Cocoon markets. Cocoon market favors the reelers as cocoon is a perishable item. So the farmers cannot keep the cocoon with them for a long time. They have to sell it. Because of this, the reelers have their monopoly. What they do? They fix the price and the farmer has to sell it at that particular cost. Price is affected by supply and demand also. So if supply is more, then price will usually go down. The rearing of silkworm is done by almost all the states, but it is only few states where reeling is done. And these reeling centers, they dictate terms to the farmers at what cost they are going to purchase the cocoons. Though we have centralized marketing federations by the central silk board and state governments so as to protect the rearers from the monopoly of reelers and middlemen, but still manipulation of price and interstate smuggling of cocoon is a big problem. Thank you.